not because Paul is a fern expert, and ferns are very interesting. They're quite diverse. That we might want to look into a little bit of their distribution, evolution, how old they might be, and a variety of things. So we have a little list of things on our cheat sheet here that I'm going to ask Paul and see what we can find out here. So Paul, I'd like to start with, what is a fern anyway?
Okay, there's interestingly probably not a single character that I can come up with that will define all ferns. But except for the fact that they all share a common ancestor, a unique common ancestor that's probably 350 maybe million years old. In terms of looking at them, you don't see one structure. There are a few characteristics that among those will be unique to ferns. One of the distinct characteristics, of course, is that they bear spores. They're not like the flowering plants. There are no seeds on them. They reproduce via spores. But that's not unique. They are a group that has both spores and they have true leaves. And those two characters between them are getting pretty close. The leaves, as they develop, uncoil. And it looks like the head of a fiddle. And that's referred to as the fiddle head. Those three characters between them, that if you've got those three characters, there's a fairly good chance that you're looking at a fern.
Okay. Let's see. So you mentioned estimated 350 million years ago with a common ancestor. What would you say, if that was a possible estimated time of origin, when maybe were they most abundant? Where might they be most diverse in a current global situation around the world, and maybe even in the U.S. where ferns more common and types of habitat that go with the distribution?
Well, starting with the age, ferns have always been a fairly significant component of the Earth's flora, never a very large component. But you first see them in the fossil record in the Carboniferous. And some of the groups that you see living today can be found as far back as 250-300 million years ago. The majority of ferns that you see, the ones you're seeing around us right now, however, belong to about 80% of the species we know, all belong to a group that didn't arise until about the Cretaceous, so after flowering plants were already around. So most ferns...
And that was about 250 million?
No, this would have been about between 100 and 200 million, something like that. That's probably about when the majority of where the common ancestor, and most of the modern ferns live. So most ferns are really relatively new compared to the age of the flowering plants, at least. Now, the only time that I'm aware of where ferns really dominated was after the end of the Cretaceous. There was this massive extinction. One of the theories for that was a massive asteroid hitting the Earth somewhere in Mexico. And in the aftermath of that that event, the sun was blocked out by ash and dust for months, maybe years, and everything, or lots of things, died, including the dinosaurs and most of the plants. And then shortly after that, if you look at the fossil record and focus just on pollen and spores, you find a period, and I'm not sure how long this period lasted, but you see mostly fern spores. So it seems like after that event, the ferns colonized what was left of the Earth earlier than other plant groups. Now, it didn't kill off all the sea plants. They recovered as well, but I don't think things recovered as quickly as the ferns. So there was this spike in fern diversity, or rather fern abundance relative to other plants. I'm not aware of any other periods in the fossil record that show that dominance. But You find ferns almost everywhere. They're particularly well known in the understory of rainforests. They become more diverse towards the tropics, as do most organisms, more species. But you also find them in high up in alpine areas. You find them in very dry deserts. And different species have different habitat characteristics, just like you see in
the sea. You mentioned plants earlier while we were talking that the ferns have, in their chloroplast, they have photosynthetic material that they could do, go through photosynthesis with a different wavelength, thus allowing them to be an understory species?
Yeah, ferns seem to have some unique pigments, or pigments different from those seen in flowering plants, and they appear to be able to absorb light in the kind of wavelengths you will see in an understory like this. And it's thought that they've been doing this, and a lot of the diversity of ferns arose essentially in these kinds of understories, both temperate and tropical.
Okay. And in the contemporary global sense, ferns today are probably most abundant and diverse where?
In the tropics, particularly New World tropics and Southeast Asia. As you get into the temperate regions, you still see, as you can see behind us and around us, a lot of actual plants. The biomass is still a good proportion ferns relative to everything else, but the species diversity is low relative to the tropics. In Europe, there are only a couple of hundred species. North America seems to have a few more, but it's estimated that there are perhaps about 9,000 named species, and there are probably several thousand more that have not been discovered and named. So perhaps 12 to 15,000 species worldwide is an estimate.
And in continental U.S., ferns are most diverse in east, here in the west, this part of the west?
I think there are more species in the eastern United States. I'm not 100% sure of that, but I think there are more species in the east. But the counteracting to the number of species, you've also got just a lot of diversity. You've got a lot of biomass here, as you can see. These are fairly large plants that are surrounding us right
now. Now, most ferns are perennial?
Most ferns are perennial. Some of them can be quite long-lived, especially some of the tree ferns in the tropics and subtropics.
What do you mean by long-lived?
30 to 40 years I know about. If it's older than that, I don't know. But there are a couple of species that have a shorter lifespan towards annuals, but that's relatively rare in ferns. Most are long-lived perennials.
So it would be very unusual to have an annual or biennial. They're pretty much all perennial.
Most of them, yeah.
I don't know of any that I've ever encountered in North America that were other than perennial.
There's an aquatic fern called Ceratopterus, and I believe, at least in cultivation, that it can become annual.
Okay.
It may also be long-lived perennial. It certainly has an unusually short life cycle for a fern.
Which brings up habitat as we go from how old to where to diversity. Ferns typically preferred, I know that they're scattered across all kind of habitats, but where they're really abundant, like here, are these moist soils, damp, what kind of conditions?
They generally like well-drained soils, but as any other plant, each species has its own set of preferred soils. Some do prefer acidic soils, but again, it's generally species-specific preferences, but they tend to be in well-drained soils. You don't see a lot of fern species growing in the waterlogged wetland soils.
And so we have several aquatic ferns. We have several that prefer really wet conditions, but the majority of them are just mesic to upland.
Yeah, you'll see many species. We'll perhaps see some today close to the waterfalls, like the maidenhair fern. It's typically in very moist areas, but it'll still be in well-drained areas where the roots can get oxygen. You won't see these growing in boggy, waterlogged soils. The aquatic ferns will actually be often floating or rooted in standing water. They are unique. They have some distinct characteristics of their life cycle compared to other ferns. And a lot of them don't even look like ferns. But you look closely, you will see that uncoiling there.
I don't know if we're jumping ahead on this question, but the rooting, are most of them fibrous, or are they rhizomatous, or what, along?
So most ferns have rhizomes, which are technically underground stems from which the roots emanate. And there are two kind of extreme forms you can see actually around us. You can see these ferns, these are sword ferns, and they're growing in clumps. So the rhizome is very contained, and the leaves all emanate from that same area, so they form something that looks like a rosette.
Are these connected?
No, these will be, each little clump of leaves, of fronds, is a distinct individual.
Okay.
that grew separately. There's some other ferns on the forest floor where you see a single leaf coming out of the ground, and then a few meters away you'll see another leaf coming out of the ground, and these are connected by a single underground and it can often be branched rhizome, and so that's the stem, and then the leaves grow up. So you'll see these leaves scattered around, and they'll all be one individual. Some ferns that do this, such as the bracken fern, their rhizomes can stretch 100 meters, and so the individuals can be quite large, made up of hundreds of fronds.
Okay, I didn't know that. So we mentioned that we have aquatic ones, we have ones that are in wetter areas, but as far as wetlands or uplands, probably the majority of ferns, would you say, are in more upland situations?
Yeah, when you get into areas such as fens and bogs where it's distinctly wetland habitat, in terms of the true ferns, I don't think you see many species. You may run into some of the horsetails, and horsetails are grouped with ferns. They're relatives of the ferns, but they're often not considered true ferns. And but they have several species that, to me, look like they're growing in wetland habitats.
And then we have another series of ferns that are epiphytic.
Oh yes, and those you tend to find much more in the tropical areas, particularly cloud forests and rainforests, and all different types of epiphytic ferns, but they form a very significant component of plants that grow on other plants. Some of them have some unique adaptations, such as scales on the leaves that help absorb water and even nutrients from water drops and rain that are falling around them.
And are they the ones I've seen other than Polypodium? They typically, the epiphyte ferns are all small?
I've seen a few filmy ferns that can have fairly large leaves.
But
you see some that have these strap-shaped leaves that are small but can be quite long.
Okay.
So they're not all tiny.
No.
Some of the Polypodium ferns you get around here can be 10 to 20 centimeters long.
Okay. My notes here. Oh, one that probably a lot of people want to know about is edibility.
Ah, yes. So there's we probably don't know exactly how many ferns are edible. There's the ostrich fern that grows in the eastern United States that is prized for its fiddleheads, the the leaves that are uncoiling out of the ground in the spring, and they taste, they have the texture of asparagus. The few times I've had them, they really? Didn't have quite as much flavor.
Yeah, I didn't think they taste like asparagus.
Yeah, I wasn't crazy about them, but I didn't dislike them. Now, I've also eaten the fiddleheads of bracken fern, which to me actually had a bit more flavor, but I've been told that that's not such a good idea. They contain toxins that are probably not too good for you. And I think if you ate them every day for a few years, you would probably do some harm. They are eaten in several parts of the world, and those areas tend to have high incidences of things like stomach cancer, but we don't know cause and effect for sure. But there is probably a lot of other species of ferns whose fiddleheads are tasty and perhaps not toxic, and they haven't yet been exploited as a food source.
Now I'm going to pull a card off the bottom of the deck here, Paul,
for it,
and ask you, why do you have an interest in ferns? What attracts you to the ferns? Is it the biology? Is it the growth form? What brings that interest?
I think I was introduced to them as a student many decades ago, and I never lost interest. I think that's the best way to describe it. If you study flowering plants, they've got these bright colored flowers often, and they've got seeds, and they've got fruits, and they've got all these characteristics that you can use to study them and figure out how they're related. And with ferns, we've got a limited number of characters. So you've got to be much more of an investigator and dig deeper, look at more characters in more detail, simply because you have fewer characters, to figure out aspects of their biology and their history and evolution.
So it's the very fine to finer set of characteristics, a little bit more challenging.
I find it a bit more challenging. But at the same time, there are about 250,000 species of flowering plants, and there's only 12 to 15,000 species of ferns. So at the same time, it's much more manageable. But it's more a matter of, I was introduced to them, I found them fascinating, and I simply never lost interest. And I'm interested in flowering plants as well, but the ferns I keep coming back to. I also like the places they grow. They tend to grow in just wonderful places.
And then another question that we've been talking for 2 days straight about, and that's been the new science of using DNA and phylogenetics and relationships. And I even think I told you I wouldn't ask you this, but I'm going to ask you anyway. So in the modern science of phylogenetics and looking at species and divergence using DNA and DNA sequencing, has that resolved a lot of questions about species? What has that brought to the topic?
It really has resolved many questions about how the major groups of ferns are related. So the families and groups of families. We now have a really solid family tree of ferns. We know how most of the branching patterns in that family tree look like. And so for most situations, it has helped figure out those relationships, how best to name the groups, and to figure out which characteristics of the ferns themselves are good indicators of relationship and which are bad indicators. And there's several characteristics that we'll be talking about later that appear to be very, 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 very good at defining these little subgroups that all share their own set of common ancestors. At the same time, it's revealed patterns that are a little bit awkward for people trying to identify things in the field. The most abundant family of ferns is probably the Dryopteridaceae, and we've already seen Dryopteris growing here today. And Dryopteris is in this group of those modern ferns with seven or eight other families. The problem is, there's no single morphological feature that I'm aware of that defines that family. So you can't look for one character and say, okay, this is dropped to a base ECU. Unfortunately, what you have to do, and most keys will go through this, you first figure out which big group of families it belongs to, which is fairly easy. And then you have to eliminate the other seven or eight families. And what you're left with is this huge worldwide group of species. And then when you go through the genera to key out the genera of Dryopterodaceae, the genus Dryopterus itself, it doesn't appear to be defined by any single set of unique morphological features. And there's no reason why it should be. There's nothing magical about evolution that says each set of descendants of a common ancestor must share a distinct morphological feature. There's no theory in evolution that says that has to be the case. And so once the DNA data combined with the phylogenetic analyses sorted out these relationships, it made life a lot easier in some instances, and it made life a little bit more challenging in other cases. Overall, I think it helped.
Okay, so, but in other words, the concepts of these major families, major genera, pretty much the DNA holds them together, they hold up pretty well.
So the first two decades of this type of work, two and a half decades, was focused on the DNA that's in the chloroplast, the structure in the leaves that makes the leaves green. And that's a very small genome with only about 80 to 100 genes, and we focused on just a few of those genes. And now, as more tools become available to molecular biologists, we're able to start looking at the main genome where the main chromosomes are, and look at some of the genes there, and look at how similar the DNA is, and how the family trees are revealed by those DNA similarities. And we're getting the same big picture. If anything, now, because we can look at more genes instead of just one or two, we can look at 20 or 30, we're getting actually more resolution.
This could go on all day, but I got to ask another one. And that is, so I understand ferns have high chromosome numbers and ploidy levels where the chromosomes are doubled or tripled. Could you take a moment and sort of give us a little overview of that?
Multiple things going on. So ferns will double their chromosome numbers quite frequently, but flowering plants do the same thing quite a lot. And so you see this doubling pattern. But even if you forget the recent doubling and just look at the lowest chromosome numbers that you see in ferns, and compare those to flowering plants or all seed plants, the ferns still have very high chromosome numbers. Ferns include a certain species of adder's tongue that's found in the Himalayas that has more chromosomes than anything, over 1,000, 1,400.
Get out.
Yeah. So if you work on most flowering plants, you can actually sit there and count seven or eight chromosomes, and I don't know how you'd count 1,400 chromosomes.
Yeah, really.
So there's a lot of chromosomes there. And on top of that,
is there any theory why they get such high numbers?
Multiple theories have been put forward, and they relate to the distinct ways in which ferns reproduce. That was one of the most famous theories put forward originally back in the 1970s. But most of the experimental tests of that theory have kind of negated the theory. I'm not sure if it's fully rejected yet, but there's certainly no consensus. I don't think you'll find someone who studies ferns who believes we know exactly why ferns have high chromosome numbers. It's a problem that I think the new generation of fern biologists will crack within the next 20 years, is my prediction. The other thing that ferns tend to have is not just lots of chromosomes, but their genomes are quite large. A typical fern genome is about three times the size of our own genomes. Oh. And that can go much to 10 times that easily. So ferns don't just, there's not a good relationship across plants between how big the genomes are and how many chromosomes there are. That's a poor correlation across plants, but in ferns, those are correlated.
So you're telling me that this fern frond leaf, the genome size of this is three to 5 times or 10 times larger than my genome.
This, yeah, I think this one's between 2 and 3, this one here.
Okay,
yeah.
And
I'll have to check.
I'm many more sizes bigger than this fern.
Oh, yeah.
Amazing. Well, I think that for an overview here, before we go into doing key structures to identify plants, I thought Paul's background and his depth of knowledge, we would just try to bring a little bit of background and interest to ferns other than how to identify them. And a name is a name. I think there's much more interesting things about ferns. And so with this, you have anything you want to add before we cut, Paul?
The only other thing I would add is they have a life cycle. It's a little bit different from most of the plants you see. Fundamentally, it's the same. But if you look under the leaf of most ferns, you'll see these things that some people think are diseases or insect eggs or something. But these are the reproductive structures, and this is where the reproductive structures are produced. And this is where the chromosome number goes to half the normal chromosome number. When animals do that, this undergo meiosis, they produce gametes, egg and sperm, that have half the normal number of chromosomes. When plants do that, they produce spores. And spores are different from gametes, because spores don't have, they don't combine immediately. They disperse, and this is why ferns can disperse very, very long distances, because these spores are microscopic. They can get up into the wind currents, even into the jet stream. They have beautiful architecture that has things like flaps and ridges that can help catch the wind. And those spores that have a half the chromosome number will land in a suitable spot, which can be something like a road cut or an upturned tree, and that will grow up into an individual haploid fern. But it's not the fern that you'll see here. This one's quite tiny. It's not quite microscopic, but it's only 1 or 2 millimeters long. And that's the sexual stage of a fern. In a flowering plant, that sexual stage is deep inside the flower. But in a fern, it's an independent structure growing on the forest floor. Some of these will produce eggs. Other of these little plants will produce sperm. The sperm are motile. They'll have little tails, and those sperm will swim over to a little plant that has an egg, fertilize it, and out of that tiny microscopic structure, you get the new fern growing that has the normal chromosome number that's been restored after fertilization. So a little bit different from the seed plants, because that sexual structure is independent. So you have an alternation between this diploid structure with twice the number of chromosomes and that little haploid structure that you can find if you know where to look and you're prepared to get your down on your hands and knees and look around with a dissecting scope, and you can find them.
And the diploid is referred to as the...
That's the sporophyte, and the sexual stage is the gametophyte.
And that's the haploid.
The gametophyte produces the gametes, the egg and the sperm.
Right, and you can look online for life cycles of these, but I think it's very interesting that... If Paul was saying if it was a little bit wetter here right now, we could find haploid, the gametophytes, on different rocks and places, but it's quite dry right now, so we're not seeing any. Okay, well, with that, I think we'll sort of end the natural history part, and we'll start setting up to look at the parts and pieces and some of the terms that one needs to identify ferns, and we'll do that here in a few minutes. All right, thank you.